Okay, good morning all. So that I'll go with the remaining problems in heat exchanger by NTU methods. Once this is done, I'll wind up this chapter. The last topic left out in this is the compact heat exchanger after these problems. So that for that compact heat exchanger, that has included only this semester. Means this is the new syllabus that has been included, compact heat exchanger. So what I'll do is, I have done the PPT of the compact heat exchanger, and the same has been shared in the Google Classroom. Okay. Google Classroom only, I have shared the compact heat exchanger PPT. Please go through the PPT, whatever I have done with the compact heat exchanger. Anyhow, today here I'll explain the compact heat exchanger. Whatever is the possible way, I'll explain the compact heat exchanger. And you have to go for the Google Classroom. There you can download the PPT of compact heat exchanger. And the entire heat exchanger notes is available in Google Classroom. All of you can download the entire heat exchanger notes. There I have divided the notes into two parts. One is before NTU methods, that is by using LMTD method, those topic I have done one PDF file. And other, after NTU method, by using a graph, NTU, those methods I used one more PDF file. I uploaded one more PDF file so that you can download for the entire notes of heat exchanger. Because today I am going to wind up this chapter. Okay, along after this problems, I'll take 10 minutes to explain about the compact heat exchanger. That is the last topic in the heat exchanger. Okay. So before that, I'll go with the problems. Yesterday, we have done the problems till in a parallel flow heat exchanger, oil is cooled. Till there, it is completed. Now, I think probably two more problems are left out. If I complete these two, all the type of problems will be completed, covered in heat exchanger, either in LMTD, NTU, or by using a graph method, or it is also called as the chart method. Everything is done. Clear? So one more problem is left out. I think probably I'll read out the question and check out. An oil is cooled to 375 degrees centigrade in a cooler or a heat exchanger by transferring its heat. Correct? That is the question, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'll go for that question first. Then after these two questions, I will go with the explanation of PPT regarding the compact heat exchangers, and I'll wind up the chapter today. Okay. An oil cooled heat exchanger, it is cooled, that is TH naught cooled to, can you see TH naught is equal to 375. See, if anybody cannot see means please let me know. I will try my best to adjust the board. Anyhow, I change the position today. Somebody has messaged me that I cannot see this blur. I have adjusted. If still,
sir, can you please move it to a bit left, sir?
Left, huh? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So then TC naught is equal to 300 degrees centigrade. And I'm using the bold color also now because you can see easily. Then what he is telling, it is heated during the cooling, it leaves the cooler at the end of the day. However, it is required that oil must be cooled down to 350. See, in the present situation, it is cooling to 300 degrees centigrade. Okay. And outlet temperature of hot fluid is 375. But what he is expecting, this temperature should still reduce to 350 degrees centigrade. That means I'll take this as TH naught for case 2. This is for case 1, which is actually right now. And he's expecting it to be for 350. So if I want that TH not to be 350, what should be the thing? Can you tell? So I'll draw the data. Okay. I'll draw the data first, then I'll explain. Then TCI is how much? Temperature of cold water inlet is 288. Then THI, that is also given, 425 degrees centigrade. Length 1 is 2 meters. That means, so I'll draw the figure. It is a parallel flow, that is also given. Parallel flow heat exchanger. If it is a parallel flow heat exchanger, this is the graph we are having. So this is called hot fluid, and this is one more is called, this is called cold fluid. Okay. THI, TCI, hence it is parallel flow, TH naught, TC naught. So for this, to attaining the temperature of TH naught and TC naught as 375 and 300, this is the length we are having, correct? So what is the length of this to attaining these two temperatures? The length of the heat exchanger is, that is L is equal to 2 meters. What he is expecting that if the outlet temperature of the hot fluid is still reduced, means if it is still processed further, till what? In the last problem, what we did? It has to till process till both the temperature reach the same point. But here he is not telling like that. He is telling TH02 supposed to be 350 degrees centigrade. If I reduce that, if I increase the length till the TH02 is 350 degrees centigrade, what will be this temperature? It will not be same as we did in the last problem, correct? TC02 will not be same. He is asking that, as well as instead of increasing that length, what is the length of the heat? Instead of 375, if I reduce it to 350, what is the length to? How much? He is asking. In the previous problem, what he did? He told that if I go on increasing the length of the heat exchanger, at some point these two curves will meet, and those two temperatures will be same at the exit. So he is asking to find out that temperature. Now he has not restricted that both should be same temperature. He is telling only temperature of hot fluid should be 350 instead of 375. So what will be TC0, means at outlet condition of the cold fluid, and what is the length of the heat exchanger? This is given. Okay, so we'll solve this. We'll try to solve this. Only this is the data given. So how to proceed further? So please take the figure. I'll rub this and I'll write here. Take the figure and datas. Please take the figure and the data. I'll give the solution here only, so that I think probably you can see. This is the best way you can see. Copy that. Can you see? Can anybody see? Can anybody cannot see? If not, please let me know. Okay. I hope you are done. Shall I rub this? Okay. I'll rub the data. I'll proceed with the solution. So what he is asking? He is asking to find out the length of second case. So length of first case is 2 meter. If it is 2 meter, all the four temperatures we know. If it is length 2, we know only three temperatures. We don't know the third temperature, that is TC0, and we also don't know the length. He is asking you to find out the length, that's all. So I'll run this. I'll give the solution here only with that data. You remember the data whatever given. So by taking the help of energy balance equation. Energy balance equation, or it is also called as law of conservation of energy. We can also call that as law of conservation of energy. What is law of conservation of energy equation? MC, CPC, TC0 minus TCI, that must be equal to MH, CPH, THI minus TH0. This is the law of conservation of energy. So what is the product of these two? Product of these two and product of these two is called heat capacity. This is mass specific heat. If I combine those two, then we'll get heat capacity of hot fluid, CH, TC0 minus TCI, that is equal to CC, THI minus TH0. So this is the equation we got. Now, you know, for the case one, now let us do for the case one first. For the case one, we know all the four temperature. What is TC0? TC0 is 300. TCI is to CH 300 minus 288, that is equal to CH. Why I'm writing CH as it is? Because I don't know mass, I don't know specific heat. I'll keep it as it is. This is same as last problem. And 425 minus 375. So remember, I'm doing for the case one. So if you do the ratio, then what will happen? The ratio of CH by CC will be equal to this ratio of CH by CC will be equal to the ratio of this and this. So that will be around, I hope, 12 by 50, correct? If you subtract this, 12 by 50 will get the answer.
Sir, MC into CPC is CC.
Sorry. This is CC, exactly. And this is H.
Yes, sir, it should be.
Yes, correct. Because usually till now, for all the problem, I used to write hot first, then I used to write cold. I forgot.
Sir, CH, sir.
This is CH. Clear? So the ratio of CH by CC will be equal to how much? This is correct, 12 by 50. The ratio yes, of CH by CC is 12 by 50. Therefore, can you get the value of C minimum and C max? So for us, you came to know C minimum is 12, C maximum is 50, and the ratio of C is equal to C minimum by C max. So what is the ratio of those two values? 12 by 50
0.25.
So till now it is same as the previous problem what we did. Next, after this, what is our intention? Our intention is to find out the length of the second exchanger. Length of the second heat exchanger. Correct.
So what is
I love this. Will you did you copy?
Yes, sir.
Copy till here. I'll go for the next. I'll go for the next step. See here, this problem we are going to solve by combining LMTD method and NTU method. Check out how we are going to combine, how we are going to solve the problem. I'll explain how to combine the LMTD and NTU method to solve the problem. And there is no rule, you have to follow this procedure and that procedure, because in this problem, he has not given which method to be adopted and all the four temperatures are given. So you can solve by any method.
So what are the cases you are taking?
Cases, sir. This case one indicates all the four temperatures are given. And the case two is only three temperatures given, but the temperature of hot fluid outlet is, in the case one, it is 375. In the case two, it is 350. So if it is 350,
yes,
he is asking what is the length of the heat exchanger to be increased. I love this.
Okay.
So after this, you go with, what is the general formula? Q is equal to CH THI minus TH naught. That is also equal to UA LMTD. Correct? This is also called as UA LMTD. So first let us find out LMTD for the case 1. What is LMTD for case 1? Theta I, theta naught. I think probably I have given the figure. You check out the figure and write, tell the value. So theta I will be equal to 300 from the case 1 and theta naught will be equal to 375. So LMTD will be equal to LMTD for case 1 will be equal to 102.9 degree centigrade. You calculate and check out the value. Once the LMTD is known, you try to apply this back in this step. If I apply back, how the equation reduces, check out here. This Q that is equal to, or instead of Q, what I'll do is I'll equate these two equations. THI minus TH naught, that is equal to UA by CH into LMTD, correct? So what is UA by CH? What is CH? CH is the minimum value what we got out of CH, CC and CH. So this is the minimum. So you can rewrite this as UA by C minimum into LMTD. That is equal to THI minus TH naught. So what is UA by C minimum? That is nothing but NTU. So that is equal to NTU multiplied with LMTD. So nothing, I have not done anything. The same equation. Why I have taken only these two equations? Why I have not taken CC into TC naught minus TCI? Because out of CC and CH, the CH is the minimum value. So CH I have taken here, THI minus TH. If I take this CH here, the UA by CH, that CH is C minimum. So what is the value of UA by C minimum? From the data book, you know, UA by C minimum is NTU. So I have written here, same thing. I have taken the C minimum here, UA by C minimum is called NTU and remaining is LMTD as it is. So from this equation, what I'll know? I know THI for case 1, TH naught for case 1. That is equal to, NTU is unknown, keep it as it is. LMTD I know, I got right now. So what is the unknown, unknown value I can find out? I can find out the value of NTU. The value of NTU for the case 1 is 0.485. Okay. If I know the value of UA separately, I would have substituted here. But I don't know. So I reduce this into NTU term. That's all. NTU for the case 1 is 0.485. 0.485 is the value of NTU for the case 1. Keep that. Finished? I'll rub this. So if I have any doubts, say I'm not using the entire board because somebody has told us if I write the entire board, I cannot see. So I think only this is the focused portion, I'll use this. Next. After this, I'll go for the case 2. What is the case 2? Case 2, we know THI, TH not 2, that is the case 2. TCI we know, there is no change in the inlet condition. And TC not is unknown. TC not 2 is unknown. So if there is only one unknown in the fourth out of these three temperatures, what is the equation I can use and I can find out?
Not audible.
It is not audible? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Audible.
Length 2, he is asking to find out along with TC not 2. See, for the case 2, we know THI, TCI for the case 1 and case 2 is same. Only change in the case 2 is TH not outlet temperature. So these three temperatures are already known. Only unknown is TC not 2. That can be found out. How we can find out the TC not 2? The TC not found 2 can be found out in any method. Law of conservation of energy or any method you try to follow and complete this. So what I do, I'll use this equation. Check out. Epsilon, that is effectiveness, is equal to, effectiveness is equal to, what is the formula for effectiveness? I think probably you do remember. The minimum value out of those two, CC and CH, into THI minus TH naught divided by C minimum into THI minus TCI. This will be same if I use the other also, that is CC, TC naught, TC naught 2. Here also this 2 minus TCI divided by C minimum THI minus TCI. If I equate these two, so definitely only one is unknown. What is the temperature? One temperature unknown? Only one temperature unknown is TC not 2. Because we know CH, that CH value is 12. We know CC, CC value is 50. And C minimum is 12. Out of 50 and 12, C minimum is 12. Minimum value is 12, so that C minimum is 12. All the temperatures are known except TC naught. I'll use this epsilon equation. This is there in the handbook. So what is the TC naught second condition? TC naught for the second condition will be equal to 306 degrees centigrade. You have to calculate, you substitute the values and cross check. Don't rely on the same value what I'm writing. You have to cross check the values, whatever I have given. Any doubts, please ask me.
So how did you get those theta values in that?
Which value?
The theta I is equal to 300 you took, right?
300, that is for the case 1, what was the value? See, this is the graph for the case 1, correct? This is the graph for the case 1. This is theta I, theta naught. This is THI, TCI, TEC naught, TH naught. What is THI for the case 1? THI is no change. That is 425. TCI is equal to 288. Subtract these two. 425. Huh?
So 137.
137.
Yes, sir.
137.
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. Then you write that. So I told. I don't know what is the values. What the subtraction of these two is 137. But LMTD is same, I guess. What was the value of LMTD?
Theta and theta. 1029.
Okay, theta, you change that. Theta is equal to how much?
130, sir.
130. And theta naught?
137, sir.
Theta naught is 137, huh?
Yes, sir. Theta I, sir.
Okay, theta naught is how much?
75.
Okay, 75. No problem. You substitute these two, you will get the exact value of LMTD what I written. The value of LMTD will be same. I have not changed the value of LMTD. It is 102.9. Correct?
Yes, sir.
LMTD same only, sir.
I think probably while writing theta I, theta naught, I written mistake. I written wrong. You just verify, you just update it to 137 and 75 and LRB is correct.
Okay,
correct, sir. Very good. So I told you to calculate. So this is the answer for TC naught. Case 2, outlet fluid temperature, cold fluid temperature is 306 degree centigrade. This is finished. So what is the next unknown we have to find out? We have to find out the next unknown is length of second case. Means if the outlet of cold temperature is 30 and outlet of hot temperature is 350, if it is 350, what is the length? That is called length 2. We have to find out. So how to find out that length 2? See here, outlet of hot fluid is 350, outlet of cold fluid is so much. Now we got, in that case, what is length 2? How you are going to find out? Can you try? I'll give you 2 minutes time. Please try and tell me the value of L2, length of heat exchanger, if the case is 350 and TC naught is 306. We'll see how to find out, because there are so many methods to find. You can find in any method. Our intention is to find out length 2, because all the four temperatures are known now. All four temperatures, using this as the four temperatures, you try to find out L. Did you found? You can find in any methods, because all the four temperatures are known, but only unknown is C and MC, CH and MH, that I don't know, but product of those two I know. What is CC and CH? CC is 12 and CH is, CH is 12, CC is 50. Product of those two we know. You can find out, I guess, probably. Easily you can proceed. Anybody got? No idea how to get?
So length you can find only when we have diameter. Like if you have diameter, we can find area, then using that we can find length.
Length without diameter you cannot find out, huh?
Yes, sir. We need diameter because we need to use area. Otherwise, there is no use of length.
Diameters are not given?
No, sir.
Okay. Then make use of the case 1. Means Okay. Express in terms of diameters only. I'll explain how to find out length. You tell in terms of diameters only. We'll see. Okay, I'll only explain, check out what to do for this. So you can do in two methods. What is that? Because you know all these four temperatures, you can find out LMTD. First, find out LMTD for parallel flow, because you know all the four temperatures. That is one method. I'll explain both the methods. Once you know LMTD, in the case one we did, do you remember what we did? We did Q is equal to CH THI minus TH naught, that is equal to UA LMTD. This we did. So we already got LMTD. So same way you do here. THI minus TH naught, that is equal to UA by C minimum, because CH is again C minimum, into LMTD. So what I can get from here question, this equation, this is called NTU. So take out NTU. NTU is equal to how much? Same procedure what we did in the previous case. So NTU you will get. So once you get the value of NTU, you go for, what is the formula for NTU separately right here? U A is pi D naught L divided by C minimum, that is equal to NTU for case 2. So I got the answer as 0.915. This is 0.915. So you retain U A U into pi D by C minimum as it is. This is equal to 0.915 by L, that is L2, correct? 0.915 into L2, you keep this. Similarly, what is, can you see what I'm doing? So L I have taken here, 0.915 divided by, this is L is nothing but L2, this is for case 2 I'm doing, this will be L2. So similarly, what is the case for the case 1? We have winded up only till NTU. So if you proceed further, what is the NTU? If you proceed further for case 1, what will happen? I'll write here. NTU for case 1 is equal to, I got 0.485. Correct. So this is equal to U into pi D naught L by C minimum. So what I'll do? L I take here also. 0.485 divided by L for case 1. That is equal to U pi D naught by C minimum. Hence, you know D naught for the case 1 and case 2 is same. D naught is, there is no change in the D naught, only there is a change in length. Can you try now at least? Okay. D naught is same for the case 2 and case 1. Only change in those two is the length. Can you tell what is the length value?
So 1.88 meter.
No, because 2 is the first case. Second so case, it has to be less. How much it is? Length 2 is equal to 3.8. Very good. 3.8 meters. Clear how to simplify, because there is no only one method. UA D naught is required. If you only concentrate on this, we'll stuck up somewhere. So that you concentrate in the first case also. And second case, definitely you'll get the solution of L2. 3.8 meter is the length of the second condition. What is the length of the first condition? The length of the first condition is only 2 meters. So just yes, for reducing the temperature of hot fluid from 370 to 25 degree, we got an increase in length of 1.8 meters. Understood? How to use NTU method and LFTD method for a single problem. This is the method. So whatever the problem yesterday, last class, the last problem I done, and this problem, you please prepare carefully for the exam. Because just by changing the values, he can give similar kind of problems in exam. Shri Prasad.
Yes, sir.
Understood?
Hello.
Understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, if any issue with the visibility of the board, please let me know. I changed the position today. I think probably everybody can see. If not, please let me know.
There's a change in the answer.
How much it is?
Sir, it's actually 5.77.
You check out the answer. My answer is 3.77. And anyhow, it is nearer to 8 that I written as
3.76.
Yes. I got 3.8. No issue. You verify this answer.
0.485 divided by L1, right? So L1 is equal to 2.
Yes.
And if we equate this with 0.915 by L2, so our value of L2 should be. Okay.
Got it. Why I'm equating the case 1 and case 2 only with respect to U, pi, D naught by C minimum? Because in both the cases, C minimum is same, D naught is same, pi is same, U is same. So I'm equating the case 1 and case 2, finding the length 2. Okay. I hope everybody is done. I'll go with the next problem and the last problem of the heat exchanger. I covered all the type of the problems in heat exchanger. Take care. And one more the note I wanted to tell before going for this problem is, see, what is the, when you will go for the NTU methods, whenever there is only two temperature given, we will go by NTU methods. So the same problem, if he has mentioned to solve by using LMTD method, then what will happen? You can solve, even though when two temperatures are given, you can solve the problem by using LMTD method. But the length of the problem will increase, and at the end, you have to solve the problem by using trial and error method. Means you have to equate the left and right hand side, left and right hand side. You will be having the value of one temperature, outlet temperature on both the sides. You should go on putting the values and try to see whether both are matching with each other. Okay. Till now, that kind of problem is not asked. If you ask, you can solve by using LMTD method. If I know only two temperature also, I can find. But only solution you will get with the help of trial and error method. You have to equate left and right side equation so that you will get, after 3 to 4 steps, you will come to know what is the answer of outlet temperature of one fluid. Once you know outlet temperature of one fluid, you will be having three temperature. Normal procedure, you proceed and find out the fourth temperature. Is it clear? Only the length of the problem will increase, that's all. You can find out. But easiest way to find out only when two temperatures are known with the help of NTU methods. Okay. So what is the last problem in this? The last problem is a 2-shell and 4 tube pass. Till now we have done only 1 shell. Number of tubes are we have done. 4, 6, 21, 35, everything we done. But number of shells we have done only 1. Now I'll show you the arrangement. This is 1 shell and this is other shell. Shell number 2, shell number 1. And how many tubes are there? There are 2 shell, 4 tubes. In each there are 1 tube, 2nd, 3rd and 4th. All these 4 tubes are passing through the second shell. Passing through the second shell. That's all. That is the thing he has given. He has that has to pass. The tubes has to pass through the shell 1 and shell 2. How the heat exchanger takes place. Still now you know only this much. With 1 shell, number of tubes, how to solve. If it is 2, how to solve. Okay, that is the only change in this problem. So we'll write on the, can you solve by yourself? Just by increasing the number of, so how will increase, can you tell how to solve this problem? Very simple method to solve this problem is, he is asking you to find out the area of the heat exchanger, that is A naught. What is the A naught? You know, if the same condition with the same set of data, if there is only one shell, you know how to solve the A naught. If it is 2 shell, once you find out A naught, just multiply with 2. Because the other shell is also having the same parameter, same condition, diameter, everything is same for the shell 2. The tube diameter inside here as well as here is same. So you know A naught, how to find out if there is only one shell and number of tubes. You try to find with the same procedure, and at last, hence we are having a 2 shell and all the 4 tubes are passing with the 2 shell. So multiply the answer with 2. Means the area of the tubes available here will be doubled to multiply and find out. Is it clear? Okay. So area, while substituting, you substitute like this, n into pi d naught l, and complete the problem. As usual, you find out the value. What is the area of n here? So what is the value of n? Number of tubes are 4. You take as it is 4. Try to simplify with the same procedure what we did in the previous problems. You will get A naught. That is for 1 shell, 4 tubes. So multiply with 2nd shell and you will get A naught. That is the total A of the tubes. Is it clear?
Okay. So
this is also nothing but the number of, see, same tubes, instead of passing through the 2nd shell, you can also do like this. You can bend this. You can take back the same tubes into the same shell. Then also we are doing the same thing. Correct? So here also we are doing the same thing. The same thing, if you bend back and send to the same shell, that is also same procedure. There we will take number of passes. This we will take as number of passes something. Here we will take number of pass. Number of pass is 1, but there are 2 shells. Just this is the change. Okay. I think probably you all understood. You can try to solve. And please try to solve this and submit in an assignment book. Try to solve this and submit in the assignment book. Is it clear? Only few assignment questions I have given in the heat exchanger chapter. Please, all of you, make a note. Don't tell I was not knowing what is the question given. I hope everything it is recorded. You can go back and check out what all the questions given and write down in a separate assignment book. So if you want,
I'll send this question in the group, sir.
Question I have sent already.
No, this one, sir, the assignment one.
Yes.
Huh?
This one, sir, the assignment to send one.
Yeah, that also I sent. Means you want the solution, huh?
No, sir, no, sir.
Only question.
Yes, sir.
The question is posted now. The day before yesterday only I posted the question.
Yes, sir.
So far you've only posted two questions, no, sir, for assignment from heat exchangers.
Heat exchanger, three problems with one derivation.
Okay, sir.
One problem in LMTD, two problem in NTU methods, and one derivation, that is logarithmic mean temperature difference for counterflow heat exchanger. That's all with the heat exchanger chapter. Okay. So now what I do? Anybody having doubts regarding the heat exchanger? That is, just I'll brief out what all the things I have covered in the heat exchanger. In the heat exchanger, I have covered classification of heat exchanger, definition of heat exchanger, working principle of heat exchangers, problems by using LMTD method for parallel flow, counterflow, problems by using NTU method for parallel flow and counterflow, and four derivations. Two derivations with respect to parallel and counter LMTD method. Other two derivation with respect to parallel and counterflow by using NTU methods. These are all the topics I have covered till now. Is there any doubt till here? If anybody having doubt, please let me know. Because in the next class, Tuesday, I will go with the next module. That is module 4, radiation. I will go with the radiation chapter. I will not repeat this heat exchanger. If you're having any doubt, please ask me. And the topic will not be repeated in the class, regular class. Remember, whatever it is covered here, this will be considered as a regular class only. So if you're having any doubt, ask me. Okay, I hope everybody has understood. And I'll go with the only last topic left out in this chapter is compact heat exchanger. This is the first time they have included. So I have prepared the PPT for that. In that PPT, what are all the contents are there? I'll just show you, just you observe that. What are all the compact heat exchangers are there? What is the advantage of compact heat exchanger? Limitations, applications. Just I'll can you see the PPT? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. This is a small PPT where you are having only the concept of heat exchange. The chapter name is heat exchange, the topic name is compact heat exchanger. And this is the content of the presentation. Definition of compact heat exchanger, types of the heat exchanger, compact heat exchanger, advantage of compact heat exchanger, limitations of the same, applications, overall the manufacturers of compact heat exchangers in the market, and conclusion about the this compact heat exchanger. So what is the compact heat exchanger? The name itself is telling that compact, whatever the heat transfer takes place, that should take place with a minimum space. That is called compact heat exchanger, which should give high efficiency with reduced volume. That means what? Reduced volume means the length of the heat exchanger should be less, A naught should be less, and weight of the heat exchanger should be less, cost also should be less. So it is called as compact heat exchangers. Where it is generally used, whenever the space is very, very less and we want to remove the heat with a faster rate, then we'll go with compact heat exchangers. For example, you take the laptop. At the bottom of the laptop, after running the laptop to a number of hours, what will happen? The heat will generate at the bottom of the laptop. Earlier, how used to cool? There was an extra attachment where the fan was kept outside and we used to cool. But now what has done? They have introduced a compact heat exchanger inside the laptop. Understood? This is one example I'm giving. Similarly, in the spacecraft, there also the space will be minimum where they are going to launch satellites. The space will be very, very minimum where heat is generating because continuous running of the IC chips, the heat will generate. They want to remove the heat as early as possible with a minimum space. then instead of going with the conventional heat exchangers, they will go with compact heat exchangers. Clear? So that is the application of compact heat exchanger and introduction of the compact heat exchanger. Next. Coming for the type of compact heat exchangers. Here I listed only a few types of compact heat exchangers, which are most important type. Plate and frame heat exchangers, brazed plate heat exchangers, welded plate heat exchangers. See, all these three, first three types are almost similar. If you see, you cannot differentiate what is the difference between these three type of heat exchangers. The working is same, but only the construction of those three types of heat exchangers are different. See, in the first type, I'll show you the video. In the first type and second type, what is the first type? In the first type, the heat exchanger is built with the help of external bolt and nut assemblies. In the second types, they are going to brace. Instead of bolt and nut assembly, they are going to brace the plates. Arrangement is same. If it is completely braced, then it is called as brazed plate heat exchanger. And similarly, if it is welded, just a small modification. If it is welded, then it is called as welded plate heat exchanger. The working of all the three is almost similar. I'll show you the video. Then the spiral heat exchanger. I'll show all this. Then plate and fin heat exchanger, printed circuit heat exchanger, and compact shell tube and heat exchanger. There are seven types of compact heat exchangers. Next. So this is the first type. Plate and frame heat exchangers. Can you see here? I've given the link for the YouTube. If you just click on that, you'll identify how the heat exchanger work here. So here it is a dismantled view and it is an enlarged view. The compact heat exchanger is very, very small in size. You can see with the video. So how it works? One side there is a provision for hot fluid and one side there is a provision for cold fluid. Where it will go inside, the cold fluid will go inside, it will do its work and come back with the hot condition. So how it will work, you please go through the YouTube video so that you'll come to know how it will work. Okay. The link I given for all the types. And the detailed working principle of that heat exchanger is given. This is the most common type of compact heat exchanger. It consists of a plates and gasket. Material used in this is stainless steel, titanium, non-metallic. Operation limit. There is a limit for this. It can operate only up to minus 35 degrees centigrade to maximum 225. But in the normal heat exchanger, what we did, the temperature went around 800 degrees centigrade also. But here, there is a limitation of temperature. And pressure up to 25 bars. Flow rate up to 5000 meter cube per hour. Okay. Next. This is the next side that is called brazed plate heat exchanger. As I told, this is similar, construction is almost similar to the first kind. But only change is the plates are brazed here. In the first case, the plates are assembled with the help of bolted nut assembly. Here it is brazed. That means one time manufacturing, if it is done, we cannot disassemble it. Okay. That is an advanced method of the first case. And this is the limitation. See the limitations here. This can work up to minus 195 degrees centigrade to 200. And the pressure, it can go up to 300 bars. And this is welded plate. This is also almost similar to that earlier cases, but there is the plates are welded in between, and I've given the link for the working principle. You please go through. And this is the working principle. This is the condition for the welded plate heat exchanger. And this is called spiral heat exchanger. This one is more interesting. If you please go through this, even though it looked like a very, very small, the efficiency of this is more compared to other types. You can check out why it is more and how the water flow, the hot fluid and cold fluid flow inside, everything. That working principle I've given in the YouTube. Please, all of you go through. All the videos are just 2 to 3 minutes. You please have a time and go through that working principle. And this is the condition where it can work up to 400 bars and the pressure up to 25 bars. And it depends upon the gasket material. Whatever the gasketed material you're using depends upon that it can work. And this is called plated fin heat exchanger. So this is the condition for that. And this is called printed circuit, where by using a 3D printing like arrangement, we are going to print the entire heat exchanger and the entire heat exchanger work by using the this arrangement. Heat exchanger takes place. And this is a what are the condition for that working principle. See the pressure, it can go up to 600 bars. In the first case, it can only go to 20 bars. Now it is 600 bars, it can work out. And temperature range is minus 200 to 900 degrees centigrade. That's the advantage of this type of heat exchangers. And this is compact shell and tube heat exchanger. This shell and tube heat exchanger, what we did is same as this one, but size is smaller. That's all. And I have not given the much construction for the shell and tube heat exchanger because this is almost same as a normal shell and tube heat exchanger. But if the size is reduced, we'll call it as shell and tube heat exchanger with a compact Right. And this is advantage of compact heat exchanger. So you can see improved energy efficiency, that is the thing, but improved heat transfer, smaller volume, it has to be, because as the name indicates, compact, it should be smaller in size, high efficiency, low cost, multi-stream, tighter temperature control, power saving, improved safety. All these are the advantage of compact heat exchanger. And there is some limitation. This is more expensive, because to make it construction, it will take more consumes more amount. And blockage can also vary because of the smaller size between the plates. There may be chances of blockages, or there may be chances of fouling. And then preparation of small pieces. See this one, the fouling. So all these are the limitations. And these are all the applications. It can be used in automobile, marine, aerospace, aircraft, cryogenic system, refrigeration. So, but till now, it has not entered to the automobile part, but it can be used in the automobile application. And these are all the manufacturers for the small scale compact heat exchangers. And conclusion totally, you came to know from this, there are so many types of compact heat exchangers which will be having a higher efficiency with a smaller space. So all those things I concluded in the form, 4 points. Okay, this is a small PPT for compact heat exchangers. Understood? So I don't know how depth he is going to ask in the compact heat exchanger, but I have taken only the introduction part of compact heat exchanger. I think this is more than enough as per your syllabus. He has not mentioned about the problems in compact heat exchangers, nothing. Just he told about the compact heat exchanger. So I have given working principle of all the compact heat exchangers and what you mean by the compact heat exchanger, advantages, applications. Is it clear? Okay. I think probably heat exchanger chapter, I'll conclude now. I will go with the next chapter from next class, that is called as radiation, module 4. In the module 4, there is only one chapter called radiation. If I complete that radiation chapter, that module will be completed. There is no two chapters in the module 4. That is our biggest advantage for you. If you prepare for that, you can address two questions there. Okay. So all of you, please type your revision number. You can leave. If you're having any doubt, please first discuss. If not, you can type your revision number and you can leave the class. Thank you. We'll meet again on Tuesday with the new chapter, radiation.
Thank you, sir.
Dheeraj, type your resume, you can leave. Kunal, Nikhil, Rishabh, Varun. Just type your resume number so that I take the attendance, you can leave the class. Yes, Dheeraj, Kunal, Nikhil, Rishabh, Varun.
Typing.
Okay.
Yes, sir, finish, sir.
Yeah, you can leave the class. Tuesday, I'll start with the new one.
Yes, sir.
Kunal, Nikhil, Rishabh.